Hello friends, good afternoon and welcome to CEC live lectures. Dear friends, today in chemistry we will be starting with coordination chemistry, and in that we will look at the introduction to coordination theory and Werner's theories of coordination compounds. To discuss this topic we have with us our subject expert Dr. Navneet Manav. Dr. Manav is senior assistant professor in department of chemistry in Dalhousie College, University of Delhi. She has written 2 books and several international publications as well. Without further ado, I would like to welcome ma'am to our studios and request her to start the lecture. Welcome ma'am.
Thanks Amrit for the kind introduction, and good afternoon to the viewers. Today we'll discuss about introduction to coordination chemistry, brief history of coordination chemistry and some applications of coordination compounds, followed by Werner's theory of coordination compounds. Coordination compounds are known to human beings from the very early times. For example, artist's blue ink, invisible ink, hemoglobin, chlorophyll, they have been known to us from early times, but their formulation at that time was found to be quite difficult and complicated, so they were known as complex compounds. As metals were essential part of these compounds, they were also known as metal complexes. And invisible ink was written as cobalt chloride, COCl26H2O. Persian blue was written as artist blue, KCNFeCN2. Although in modern days we know much details about their formulation, but still the original name continues somewhere. And in modern terminology, these are known as coordination compounds. And in previous days when I was talking about invisible ink, basically this invisible ink was this complex compound of cobalt. This was used for giving coded messages, and something was written on the piece of paper with this ink that is pale pink in color, so the message was not visible at all to the viewer. But when this message was viewed under some radiations which provide heat, this gives rise to the coding of the message, that is the message appeared in blue color. And the chemistry behind this was, actually this is because of this cobalt complex, diaqua, dichlorocobalt complex, which on dissolution in water gives rise to tetraecocobalt ions, which combine and which take up these solvated species, take up these chloride ions and form this complex. And this complex basically, which when we heated, this is solid complex, pale pink in color, something is written with this, but when this is heated, this gives rise to original blue colored complex. That's why the appearance of blue colored messages was there. Basically, the coordination compounds are a type of addition compounds, and addition compounds are those compounds when any solutions of 2 or more stable salts are mixed in stoichiometric quantities and the solution is allowed to evaporate and crystallize, the new crystals of some addition compounds or molecular compounds are formed. And these addition compounds, they are of 2 types, double salts or lattice compounds and coordination compounds. Basically, double salts or lattice compounds are those type of compounds which retain their identity even in the solution form as well, which do not retain their identity in the solution form, they retain their identity only in the lattice forms. That's why they are also known as lattice compounds. Because when we dissolve these double salts in the water or in solvent, they return back to their constituent ions. And then their properties are similar to those of chemical and physical properties are similar to those of their constituent salts. Like for example, potassium alum is a double salt of potassium sulfate and aluminium sulfate. When potassium sulfate and aluminium sulfate are mixed in equimolar ratios and solution is allowed to crystallize, these crystals of potassium alum, they separate out. But these crystals on dissolution in water, they give rise to potassium ions, aluminium ions and sulfate ions. And that's why when the solution is tested for the presence of these ions, they show the positive test for potassium ions, aluminium ions as well as sulfate ions. So this potassium alum essentially behaves as its constituent ions, potassium ions, aluminium ions and sulfate ions in solution form. only in lattice form it existed as this K2SO4, Al2SO43. Similarly, Mohr salt is a compound of ferrous sulfate and ammonium sulfate. On mixing ferrous sulfate and ammonium sulfate in equimolar ratios, this compound resulted green colored compound Mohr salt is obtained. But when this compound is dissolved in water, it breaks down into ferrous ions, ammonium ions and sulfate ions. So this solution will show positive test for all these three ions. So that means this Mohr salt does not retain its identity in the solution form. So this is a double salt. For example, carnallite also, it's a salt of double salt of potassium chloride, magnesium chloride, and some 6 water molecules are there. This also gives rise to potassium ions, magnesium ions, and chloride ions in the solution form. And the solution will indicate positive test for all the three cations. Whereas the coordination compounds, they are little different from double salts in a way that their chemical and physical properties are not same as their constituent ions. Their chemical and physical properties are different. They retain their identity in the solid as well as solution form. For example, potassium ferrocyanide. Potassium ferrocyanide is formed when we mix potassium cyanide and ferrocyanide. And this potassium ferrocyanide after mixing of this ferrocyanide and potassium cyanide, they give rise to this compound potassium ferrocyanide. But this compound potassium ferrocyanide, when dissolved in water, it does not break down into ferrous ions and cyanide ions, but it breaks down into potassium ion and this hexacyanoferrous ions. So that means this complex ion retains its identity in the solution as well as solid form. So as a result, this will give positive test for the presence of FeCN6-4 ion sign only, but it will not give positive test for ferrous ions and cyanide ions. Similarly, when we add ammonia solution to copper, it gives rise to tetraamine copper sulfate blue colored compound. The properties of this blue colored compound are not same as that of copper ions and ammonium ions because it exists as this tetraamine copper ion in the solution form as well as the solid form. So this on dissolution, this will not give positive test for the copper ions. So the difference between double salts and coordination compounds are, the double salts are the constituent. When we mix the constituent simple salts in equimolar proportion, they result in double salts. Whereas for the coordination compounds, the constituent simple salts may or may not be in equimolar proportion. They may be in different proportions, they may be in equimolar proportions. And these double salts, they undergo dissociation into their constituent ions on dissolution in water, whereas coordination compounds, they dissociate into complex ions and the counter ion, but the complex ion does not dissociate in water. So in all these double salts, the ions, they behave like their constituent ions, double salts behave like their constituent ions, so they contain ionic bonds. Whereas in complex compounds, they may have ionic or coordinate bonds because they do not break down into constituent ions. So that means a compound in which central metal is attached to group of surrounding molecules or ions by coordinate covalent bond is known as coordination compound. Here coordinate covalent bond means this is different from the covalent bond. Covalent bond is formed by mutual sharing of electron between the atoms, whereas coordinate covalent bond is formed by donation of electrons from one species to another. But the difference, there is the difference only at the time of formation of bond. Once the coordinate covalent bond is formed, this cannot be differentiated from the covalent bond. So the difference is only at the time of formation of bond, where the compound, in case of coordination compound, the coordinate bond, the electrons are donated by one species, but they are shared by both the species. So the coordination compound may contain complex ion having polyatomic cations or anions. So that means polyatomic cations or anion, it essentially has a central metal ion and the ligands. So ligands basically are the ones which donate pair of electrons to these central metal atom or ion. In this case, the central metal atom or ion has to make its d orbitals, empty d orbitals available to accept lone pair of electrons from the ligands. And the ligands, they give lone pair of electrons. So the orbital of a ligand having lone pair of electron overlaps with the empty orbital of the metal and coordinate covalent bond is formed. And the branch of chemistry in which coordination compounds are studied is called coordination chemistry. So in this case, in the coordination chemistry, the most important thing is the complex ion. This complex ion is basically a transition metal ion surrounded by a number of ligands. And that is now, as transition metal ion accepts lone pair of electrons, so it acts as Lewis acid, whereas the ligands which acts as electron pair donor, they are Lewis bases. So these coordination complex ions may have this central metal ion. And then this is the ligands attached to this. This is the coordination number of these ligands. That means the number of ligands that are attached to this central metal atom or ion through coordinate bonds. And this is the charge on the this complex ion. And depending upon this charge on the complex ion, it accepts the counter ions to balance this charge. This charge on the complex ion is basically the algebraic sum of the charges on the metal ion and the charges on the ligands. In this case, this NH3 is a neutral molecule, so it does not have any charge. Cobalt is having plus 3 charge, so the overall charge on this complex comes out to be plus 3 and 0 algebraic sum of both is equal to plus 3. So to balance this, it requires 3 counter ions, 3 negative counter ions, and hence this complex becomes like this, these 3 counter ions with this complex ion. And if this charge comes out to be negative, it needs positive counter ions in that case. For example, in this case also, if we want to have, if we want to calculate the charge on this complex ion, it's the charge on this cobalt plus charge on ammonia plus charge on these chlorides. So charge on this cobalt is plus 3 charge. So 1 into plus 3 is 3 and ammonia is 0. So this contributes 0, whereas chloride is having 1 negative charge. So the contribution of chloride is minus 2, and algebraic sum of these gives rise to plus 1 charge on this complex ion. So it needs 1 counter ion, negative counter ion, to balance this to form a neutral compound. So this 1 counter ion is chloride in this case. And then type of complex ions, based on the charge on the complex ion, the complex ion can be cationic complex ion, they can be anionic complex ions. Cationic complex ions are the ones which are having positive charge on this and they need negative counter ions. Whereas the anionic complex ions are the ones which need, which are having this negative charge, like dicyanoargentate, dicyanoferrate 2 minus, and tetrachloro cuprate 2, these are having negative charge, so they are known as anionic complex ions. They need counter ions as positive, so it can be potassium KAgCN2-. And in this case, as this is tetraamine dichlorocobalt complex, 1 plus charge, so it will be counter ion here will be 1 chloride. And these if the complex ion is neutral, if the there is a complex ion does not have in having any charge, then the complex will be known as neutral complex, like tetracarbonyl nickel complex. And depending upon the type of ligands, like if in a complex there are only one type of ligands in the coordination sphere, those type of complexes are known as homoleptic complexes. If more than one type of ligands are there, then the complexes are known as heteroleptic complexes. So the type of complexes depends upon the charge as well as the type of ligands. Now, what are ligands basically? The ligands are as we know in case of complexes, the transition metal is surrounded by number of ligands. And what are ligands? Ligands are those molecules or ions which coordinate to the metal atom. And because they form coordinate bond with the metal atom or ion, they must have at least one lone pair of electrons. Generally, these are anions or polar molecules. Positively charged molecules also, but for that they must have lone pair of electron to donate to the central metal atom or ion to form the covalent bond. And depending upon the number of binding sites of the ligands, these may be differentiated into monodentate ligand, bidentate ligand, tridentate ligand, tetradentate ligand, pentadentate ligand. Like if they are binding from one site, like one atom is giving electron pair to the metal and they are binding to the metal through one site, they are known as monodentate ligand. For example, neutral molecules like water, ammonia, chloride and cyanide ions, carbon monoxide, thiocyanate ions and hydroxide ions. And for bidentate ligands, if the binding is through two positions, like in this case it's ethylene diamine molecule and binding is through two nitrogens, then this is a bidentate ligand. Glycinate ion binds through this nitrogen as well as through this oxygen. Oxalate ion is binding through these two oxygens. So in these cases, when the binding is through two sites, it's known as bidentate. When the binding is through three sites, it's known as tridentate, tetradentate, pentadentate and hexadentate. Like commonly known molecule ethylene diamine tetraacetate ion EDTA is hexadentate ligand. And generally when there is more than two binding sites, the ligand is known as polydentate ligand. And the polydentate ligands, basically they form many more than two bonds with the metal ion, and generally this type of complexes are known as metal chelates. Chelate is a Greek word, and meaning of chelate is in Greek, it's like claw of a crab. So that means these ligands, they bind to the metal atom like claws of a crab, and this type of chelates, they give stability, they form the rings around the metal and they give stability to the complexes. These compounds are quite stable, and these metal chelates, they found great applications in various fields, in medicines, in living systems and in human beings as well. And the applications of coordination compounds, the coordination compounds, they are natural process, they are quite vital to natural process, and most common examples of coordination compounds that have been known to us from the earlier times are hemoglobin, chlorophyll, vitamin B12. Hemoglobin is basically red colored pigment that gives red color to the blood, and this hemoglobin is iron porphyrin complex, basically complex of iron with porphyrin, and this hemoglobin forms is a oxygen carrier in the body. It carries oxygen from the lungs to various tissues where this oxygen is required, and it transfers the oxygen there, and oxygen is used for the various functions like oxidation of food or tissues from the oxidation of food, when carbon dioxide is released, this hemoglobin takes up this carbon dioxide from the tissues to back to the lungs. So it is the main constituent on which our respiration depends. So it's vital for the living beings. And then chlorophyll. Chlorophyll is basically magnesium porphyrin complex. It's green colored complex, green colored pigment which gives color to green plants. And these green plants are basically, these green plants which are having chlorophyll, only those are able to take this process of photosynthesis. And photosynthesis is only process which is there for the fixation of solar energy into chemical energy. This solar energy into chemical energy is required because for this photosynthesis, for this chlorophyll is required because in this case, this provides the substrate. And Third is vitamin B12. This is dark red colored compound and formed of cobalamins, and this is also essential for various body functions. And in living systems, these metal chelates, they help in storage and transfer of metal ions. For example, transferrin and ferritin. Transferrin is required for transfer of iron from the places of breakdown of RBCs, where this iron is released, to the places where this iron is required for the formation of new red blood corpuscles. So that means this transferrin transfers the iron from the breakdown places of iron to the bone marrow, where this iron is required. So there it is stored in the form of another protein, that is ferritin, which is a complex of ferrous ions with the metal ion. So that means these metal chelates, they help in storage and transfer of metal ions. They also serve as agent for transmission of energy in animals and plant metabolism. These also act as redox catalyst in many metabolic processes such as cytochrome C, where it is required for oxidation of iron 2 to iron 3. And then many enzymes like carboxypeptidase, catalase, they have metal ions or metal complexes as their basic active sites. And various functions, these basically enzymes are the biological catalyst. And catalyst, as you know, the catalyst are the ones which increases the rate of reaction. But these enzymes, they are different from these catalysts, because in the biological systems, they increases the rate of reaction many folds. As a result, the same reactions cannot be mimicked outside the body. And these metal ions and metal complexes, they play important role. One third of these enzymes, they have metal complexes or metal ions at their active sites. And only because of these complexes, some of these enzymes, they can function. And then trace metals that are present in the human body, they also, all the trace metals, generally, they function through chelate formation. In industry also, these various compounds, they are very well known and used in metal complexes or coordination compounds. For example, they are used in dyes and pigments because they render intense color to the things, like they are used in leather industry, tannin industry, paper industry, where they are required for giving color. And then they are also used for softening of hard water. Hardness of water basically is because of calcium and magnesium salts, soluble calcium and magnesium salts present in the water. These calcium and magnesium salts, they cause corrosion of the boilers by scale formation in the boilers. So it's important to remove these calcium or magnesium ions, or to pacify these calcium and magnesium ions in the hard water, so that they may not cause scaling in the boilers. So to prevent this, these sodium metaphosphate or some other compounds are added to the hard water, which form complexes with calcium ions and magnesium ion and render them unavailable for the scale formation. Hence, these prevent the boiler corrosion. Then there are certain other type of complexes like dicyanoargentate. Copper dicyanoargentate is used for electroplating of silver. Copper dicyanoaurate is used for gold plating. Potassium dicyanocuprate is used for copper plating. And these are also used in photography. For example, silver bromide is used for photographic fixing of photographic film. But after it has to be washed out. For washing of this silver bromide, we add sodium thiosulfate, which forms a soluble complex with silver as dithiosulfate argentate 1, which is soluble and is removed after fixing of the film. These metal complexes, they find major use in homogeneous catalysis for some organic substances also. Most important example is Ziegler-Natta catalyst, which is a combination of titanium trichloride and triethyl aluminium. And this brings about polymerization of compounds, organic compounds having carbon-carbon double bond. And these result in the formation of ordered and high molecular weight polymers, and these polymers are of commercial importance because they are used in common fibers, films and plastics. And then there is another, this octacarbonyl dicobalt complex. This also acts as catalyst in the conversion of olefins to alcohols. These complexes, they find use in metallurgy also. Some of the metal complexes, some of the metals like nickel, cobalt and copper, they are extracted from their ores by hydrometallurgical processes, and in these hydrometallurgy they are extracted as their amine complexes. Amine complexes are basically the complexes of these metal ions with ammonia. Those are known as amine complexes. They are extracted as amine complexes. Similarly, silver ion, MacArthur process, for the gold ions, the forest cyanide method, these methods are used for the extraction of silver and gold. In these, the metal ore containing metal is treated with sodium cyanide, excess of sodium cyanide, and excess of air is also used, and these metals then they form their soluble complexes, cyano-soluble complexes there. And after the soluble complexes are formed, these soluble complexes are removed from the ore, and the solution of these complexes on addition of zinc dust gave rise to the silver and gold metals. These also find use in the purification of metals in metallurgy. For example, in Mohn's process, nickel is purified by Mohn's process, where the nickel, that is crude nickel, is made to react with carbon monoxide and it forms tetracarbonyl nickel complex vapors. And these vapors are collected, and when these vapors are heated to 180 degrees centigrade, they give rise to pure nickel, that is about 99.9% pure. And complex formation is also used in the concentration of bauxite ore, where for the Beer's process, where the bauxite ore is digested with concentrated sodium hydroxide, and then the aluminium oxide present in the bauxite ore gets dissolved into the sodium hydroxide as sodium meta-aluminate, and impurities like silica and ferrous oxide, they remain in the solid state. As a result, this bauxite ore gets concentrated. And in medicine also, they find quite well-known uses in medicine, like cisplatin dichlorodiaqua platinum complex was the first anti-tumor agent that was used for cancer treatment. And similarly, gold complex like myocrysine was used for rheumatoid arthritis treatment. And calcium EDTA was used for treatment of metal poisoning, like for the lead poisoning. Calcium EDTA is administered orally, and where the lead forms stable complex with EDTA and is removed through the urine. Similarly, if accumulated copper, which causes malfunctioning of nervous system, this can be removed from the liver by addition of penicillamine, as penicillamine makes complex with the copper. Some of the compounds of or coordination compounds of some metals like gadolinium are used. Europium also are used for radioisotopic imaging. They are used as contrast reagents in MRIs also. Then these metal complexes, they find use in qualitative and quantitative analysis also. They are used for the detection and estimation of some of these metal ions, like nickel is detected by adding dimethyl glyoxime because it forms red colored compound with dimethyl glyoxime. Even while detecting nickel, while estimating nickel quantitatively, gravimetrically, we make its complex as nickel dimethyl glyoxime complex, from where the amount of nickel is precipitated tells us the amount of nickel present in the solution. And in brown ring test also, for the detection of iron, this complex is formed, which is the basis of the formation of a brown ring test. Calcium and magnesium, they form stable complexes with EDTA, so they can be estimated by complexometrically, volumetrically by EDTA titrations. And in colorimetric determination of metal ions, because the trace amounts of metal ions that are present in very smaller amounts that cannot be detected by other methods, this the tendency of the metals to form colored complexes with these ligands are used because they form colored complexes. The optically density of these colored complexes is measured, and from the optical density, the amount of metal ions can be detected. And this, for example, iron is estimated as its 110 phenanthrodiene complex and aluminium 3 as oxygenate complex. We'll conclude this session here. Thank you very much. Hello friends, in this session we will be discussing Werner's theory of coordination compounds. Coordination compounds have been found to be mysterious from the early times because these coordination compounds, they are brightly colored, and but compounds of some of the metals, same metal with the same oxidation state with the same ligands may have different colors. Moreover, these complexes when dissolved in water, they gave rise to different number of ions. For example, the complexes, amine complexes of cobalt, where we are having only cobalt, chlorine, chloride and ammonia there, they gave rise to different six colored, six or five type of compounds are isolated, which are different in color. Like this compound is orange in color. When we dissolve it in water, it gives rise to four ions, and only three chlorides are precipitated in this case, whereas in this compound, the same compound of cobalt, chloride and ammonia, there is another compound that is purple in color, and the ions per formula unit in this case comes out to be 3, and the number of chloride ions that are precipitated comes out to be 2, and the another compound that is green in color, number of ions per formula unit given by this compound is 2, and chloride ions that are precipitated by 1, and the similar compound which is having like same 3 chlorides, 4 ammonia, number of ions is same, number of chloride is same, but their color is different, one is green in color, another is violet in color. So to know the mystery behind these complexes, various theories were given by various scientists from the very beginning, but most of them were not able to explain the mystery of these complexes. Then there were certain theories at that time in case of in 1826 to 1894, there was Blomstrand and Jorgensen, they gave one theory known as chain theory. According to this theory, the metal ions, the number of bonds the metal ion can form is equal to valency or charge on the metal ion. For example, cobalt is having plus 3 charge, so it can form 3 bonds. So this raises similarity to organic compounds, as carbon is having 4 valency and it can form 4 bonds. As carbon can form chains of CH2, similarly it was proposed that NH3 could also form chains. But only those chlorides which are attached to NH3 could be dissociated. So according to this Blomstrand chain formula, this was the later on formula given by Werner. We will talk about the formula that was given by Blomstrand. According to this formula, number of ions predicted are 4, because this chloride which is attached to this NH3 is ionizable. this chloride is ionizable, this chloride is ionizable. So all these three chlorides are ionizable and the rest of cation left as this. So number of total ions comes out to be 4. In this case also, it was able to describe the total number of ions predicted were equal to the total number of ions that were determined. For example, this chloride, in this compound also, this chloride is dissociable, this chloride is dissociable. As a result, we are having 3 number of ions as predicted from the chain formula, Bronstein chain formula, which is same as we found experimentally. And in this compound, this only this chloride can be dissociated. So we are having 2 ions, one this chloride, another is this cation. But in this compound, the expected number of ions predicted is equal to 1 this and 1 this 2. But experimentally, no ion was found to be there. Then there was, at the same time, Werner was also working on coordination compound. He was working on cobaltamine complexes at that time. So Alfred Werner, who was Swiss chemist, he is known as founder, aptly known as founder of coordination chemistry, because formulation given by him is so far considered to be the basis of coordination chemistry. He was Swiss chemist. He examined different compounds of cobalt 3 chloride with ammonia, and from his observations, he told that the coordination compounds, there are 2 types of spheres. One is inner coordination sphere and another is outer coordination sphere. In the inner coordination sphere, the ligands are directly bonded to the central metal. And in the outer coordination sphere, the ions are attached to this complex ion. They remain ionizable and remain in the outer coordination sphere. And Werner was awarded Nobel Prize in 1913 for his coordination theory. According to Werner, what he suggested was the coordination compounds, they have 2 types of valencies. One is primary valency, another is secondary valency. And in the primary valency, this is the valency that is exercised by the metal ion in most of its constituent salts, in simple salts. Like, for example, silver forms silver chloride, AgCl. So in simple salt, the primary valency, the valency of silver is +1. So the primary valency of silver is +1. Platinum forms PtCl4. So primary valency comes of the platinum is +4. And cobalt forms CoCl3. So the primary valency of cobalt in this case is +3. And copper forms copper sulfate, CuSO4. So the primary valency of copper comes out to be 2. This primary valency is ionizable, it's non-directional, and is equal to the number of charge on the complex ion. And secondary valency is the valency that the compound, that the metal ion exercise while forming bonds with the ligands in the for the formation of complex. This is non-ionizable, this is directional, because and it is equal to the number of ligands coordinated to the metal. Or in other words, you can say this is equal to the coordination number. So the coordination number is same as secondary valency, and this gives rise to, because this is directional, so this secondary valency decides the geometry of the compound. And for example, in this complex, this is the coordination number of this cobalt. In all these complexes, basically it experiences 3 valency. Primary valency is cobalt is +3. So these 3 chloride ions, this is the primary valency, and this 6 is its secondary valency, that is also equal to its coordination number, that is the number of bonds it is forming with the ligands. And when this is dissolved in water, this gives rise to this complex ion, and these 3, the ones that are satisfying only primary valency, these are ionizable, they will ionize. And in another example, when this chloride group satisfies both primary as well as secondary valency, this will not be ionized. Only these 2 chlorides, in this case also cobalt is having +3 as its primary valency and 6 as its secondary valency. So, but this chloride ion occupies both primary, it is experiencing two dual position because it is satisfying primary as well as secondary valency, so it will not be ionized. Only these two chlorides will be ionized in this case. So the difference between primary valency and secondary valency is primary valency is ionizable, whereas secondary valency is non-ionizable. Primary valency is same as the charge on the metal ion, and this secondary valency equal to the number of ligands that are coordinated to the metal, that is coordination number of the metal ion. Generally, while denoting this in the formation of complexes, this primary valency is denoted by dotted lines, whereas secondary valency is denoted by thick lines, and primary valency can be satisfied by negative ions, whereas the secondary valency can be satisfied by negative or neutral molecules. So primary valency is non-directional, whereas secondary valency is directional. That's why it determines the geometry of the complex also. So from this, he gave this type of structure of cobalt amine complex, where these secondary valencies are shown by these solid lines, whereas the primary valencies occupied by these three chloride ions are shown by dotted lines. And these six valencies that are occupied by ammonia, because cobalt in all the complexes, it experiences three its primary valency and six as its secondary valency. And Werner was able to isolate a few different type of compounds of these cobalt amines, and depending upon his studies, he gave the formulation of these compounds. First compound is this COCl3(6NH3), which is known as luteocobaltic chloride. This is orange yellow colored compound, and in this compound also the coordination number of cobalt is 6. And basically when this compound was treated with sulfuric acid, these three chlorides, they form HCl. And that means, and moreover, on addition of, on treatment of silver nitrate to this compound, the chloride ions, they were precipitated as silver chloride, and from the amount of silver chloride ions that were precipitated, it was found that three chlorides per formula unit were precipitated. So it proposed, Werner concluded from here that all the three chlorides that are ionizable, so they will be occupying the primary valency. And then on addition of HCl to this compound, even at 100 degree centigrade, the ammonia was not removed, it remained intact, which implies that these ammonia molecules, they are occupying the secondary valency. They are in the inner coordination sphere, they are bound to this cobalt through coordinate bond, not through the ionic bond. So the formula given by Werner to this compound was CONH36, and this inside the coordination sphere, and these three chlorides which are ionizable in the outer sphere. And when from the molar conductance values, when it was found that this number of ions given were equal to 4, this is also can be satisfied by this formula, because these three chloride ions and one this complex ion, the total number of ions by this formula is again 4. And in another compound, so the formula of this compound given was this, which satisfied most of the observations for this, experimental observations of this compound. And in another compound, which is COCl3(5NH3)H2O complex, this was a roseocobaltic chloride. It was pink colored complex. And in this complex, what he observed was, again the three chlorides, they were precipitated by addition of silver nitrate as silver chloride. From the weight of silver chloride that was precipitated, the chloride ions per formula unit were found. They were found to be 3. And on addition of sulfuric acid, the compound found was cobalt sulfate, 10 ammonia molecules, 2 water molecules, which tells us that the ammonia and water, they are inside the coordination sphere, because even upon heating up to 100 at room temperature, this water is not lost. It is lost only after heating at 100 degree centigrade, which tells us, which is from where he was able to conclude that this water molecule is also inside the coordination sphere. And as a result, this compound formed is CONH35H2OCl3. These three chlorides are ionizable, but the sixth position here is occupied by water molecule. Coordination number 6 is again there, 5 positions occupied by ammonia and the one position occupied by water. In another compound, COCl35NH3, this was violet colored compound known as purocobaltic chloride compound. The coordination number was found to be 6, but the number of NH3 has decreased from 6 to 5. So, that means the 6th position in this case will be occupied by the chloride ions. So, when this compound was treated with sulfuric acid, only 2 hydrochlorides were evaporated, 2 HCl were removed, and then only 2 chlorides were precipitated on addition of silver nitrate, which means that the 2 chlorides are there which are occupying, which are satisfying only primary valency, which are ionizable. The 3rd chloride, which cannot be precipitated, is different from these chlorides in a way that it satisfies both the primary as well as the secondary valency, and this chloride is behaving as a ligand and is inside the coordination sphere. So, when this compound, from the molar conductance values of this compound, it was found that the number of ions is equal to 3, that is same from this formula, because these 2 chloride ions and 1 this ion. So, total number of ions comes out to be 3 in this case. In another compound of this cobalt Cl3 4NH3, there were actually 2 type of compounds, 2 different colored compounds were observed in this case. One was green colored complex and the another one was violet colored complex. And in this green colored complex, again the 4NH3 remained intact as the coordination number of cobalt is 6. So, 2 chlorides will be occupying the inner coordination sphere. So, that means they will be satisfying secondary valency, they will be behaving like dual role, they will be playing dual role here, satisfying both primary as well as secondary valency, and only 1 chloride is there that is occupying this position, that is denoted by these dotted lines. This compound, on addition of HCl, ammonia remains intact, that means ammonia is in the coordination sphere, and the total number of ions by molar conductance value is same, that is 2, 1 plus 1. But the difference between the compound, because the 2 compounds, they have different physical and chemical properties, means the Werner concluded from some studies that these compounds are different because chloride and both the compounds, they occupy different position. In this preciocobaltic chloride, these chlorides, they occupy trans positions, they occupy axial positions of this octahedral, whereas in other violocobaltic chloride, this chloride occupies, one occupies axial position and another one occupies the equatorial position, resulting in the formation of cis complex. That's why the properties of these 2 complexes were different. And in this complex also, actually there was one more difference. Only 1 chloride was precipitated by silver nitrate in both the complexes, but after some time, after long standing time, these 2 chlorides, they were also precipitated out. What he proposed was that these chlorides basically are precipitated, reason being these are removed by these chlorides, they are precipitated because they are replaced by water molecules present in the solution, that is why these are replaced by H2O. But the substitution of this chloride in trans as well as cis complex is different. So, that is why they behave differently, the rate of exchange of this chloride is different. So, the time of precipitation of these chloride was also found to be difficult. And in another complex of this cobalt complex, that is COCl3 3NH3, as the secondary valency of cobalt in this case is also 6 and we are having only 3 chlorides and 3NH3. So, all these, they go inside the inner coordination sphere, they occupy the inner coordination sphere and they satisfy the secondary valencies. So, these 3 chloride ions, they are not precipitated on addition of HCl, They are not precipitated on addition of silver nitrate. They are not released on addition of sulfuric acid. They remain inside the coordination sphere. And as is visible from this formulation, this was a neutral molecule. It does not give rise to any number of molecules. So what he concluded was, this is a neutral molecule having this formula. There is no counter ions, because there are no counter ions, so no ions are precipitated in this case. Now, what are the evidences in favor of Werner's theory? Werner's theory there were certain evidences from electrical conductivity measurement, which gives rise to number of charges. Cryoscopic measurements, which gives rise to depression in freezing point, which gives us the number of particles, and from the precipitation reactions, which gives rise to how many chlorides can be precipitated. So from here, in this compound, the number of particles from the cryoscopic measurement were found to be 4, number of charges 6, and if we see the formula here, the number of charges on this is plus 3, 3 are from the chloride ion, so total number of charges is equal to 6, and the number of particles again, 1 this and these 3 chloride ions, so it is the same. Similarly, for this compound, this the number of charges is plus 2 on this cationic complex and minus 2 on these chlorides, and total number of charges comes out to be 4 from the conductance measurement, and the number of particles from the cryoscopic measurement comes out to be 3. In this case also, it is CONH34Cl2, where the number of charges from the conductance measurement comes out to be 2, 1 plus this charge, and the number of particles same. And in this complex, which was not Bloom's strand theory was not able to explain this complex, but it is well explained by Werner, as there are no charges on this neutral molecule and it will not give rise to any other particle. So Werner's theory was successfully able to explain about the structure, and from there he told about the isomerism of these compounds also. He successfully explained that there is optical and geometrical isomers. He took the example of this compound. There are 3 possible structures for this compound. One is planar, trigonal prism and octahedral. And the number of isomers that we expect from these structure, if this is planar structure, chlorine occupies 1, 2 position, 1, 3 position, 1, 4 position. So, possible isomers are 3. And in case of trigonal planar, again there are 3 possible isomers. But if a structure is considered to be octahedral, the possible isomers comes out to be 2. One is where the chlorides are occupying cis position, when these chloride ions are occupying the trans position. And what he thought was, what he concluded, because only 2 isomers of these compounds were isolated, so he concluded that geometrical arrangement of the coordinating groups around the central atom was octahedral. So that means what he concluded, for most of the other compounds having 6 coordination number, the geometry is octahedral, and for the 4 coordination number, the geometry is square planar, could be square planar or tetrahedral. Like this example of this compound, where dichloroplatinum complex is there. In this complex, the coordination number of the metal is 4, and Werner found, what he found was that this molecule is planar and it existed in 2 isomeric forms. So it could be only square planar geometry, where there are 2 isomers of this dichloroplatinum complex known as cisplatin. At the cisplatin, this complex where it is in cis form, and this is the trans complex. So Werner was able to explain successfully the correct number of ions in the complexes, firm association of chlorine with cobalt in few cases, and existence of their 2 forms of the complexes, one is cis form, another is trans form, and different type of valencies, how to write the formula of these complexes was concluded from Werner's discussion only. But there are certain limitations of Werner's theory, which led to another type of theories, proposal of another theories. One was that he was not able to explain why all elements, they do not form coordination compounds, why only transition elements they form coordination compounds. He failed to explain the directional properties of the bonds in coordination compounds. Why they are directional? Why only octahedral shape is there? Why they have square planar or tetrahedral shape, which were later on explained by another theories? And he was not able to explain the color of the compound. He was able to explain that the color of the compound is different because it says it's trans or it's like this type of bonds are there. But he was not able to tell why this is violet in color, why this is red in color, why this is orange yellow in color, why the compound is pink in color. So he was not able to explain the different color of the different compounds. And similarly, the magnetic and optical properties shown by coordination compounds, he was not able to explain those magnetic as well as optical properties also of these compounds. So there are another theories required for this Werner's to overcome these limitations. There was one electronic interpretation for this Werner's theory was also given, that was given by Sidgwick and Laurie, where they explained that according to them, the Werner's primary valency is basically because of electron transfer and secondary valency is because of electron pair sharing. So that means in the secondary valency, the ligands, they donate their electron pairs, they form coordinate bond with the central metal ion. They are having at least one unshared pair of electron in their valence shell, which they can form bond with the central metal ion, where from where the orbital having those lone pairs, they can overlap with the empty metal orbital and form a coordinate bond. As a result, these two electrons are donated by the ligands, and because of this, the electrons they form due to this donation of electrons from the metal to the ions, which are shown by arrow, that means that resulted in the accumulation of charge on the metal ion, because metal is a neutral. But there is certain limitation to this Sidgwick theory also, because as a result, if the ligands they are giving electrons to the metal ion, like in case of hexamine cobalt complex, if 6 ammonia ligands are giving 12 pair of electrons to the cobalt 3 complex, it will be electron rich. But according to electron neutrality principle, this complex, which is even though it's having electron rich, so it will have to back donate its electrons, it will not be stable. And according to Sidgwick theory, that Werner's primary valency is regarded as electron transfer, amounting to electron transfer, and secondary is the same as electron pair sharing. So we'll conclude today's lecture here only. Thank you so much.
Dear friends, on that note, we would like to thank Dr. Manav for coming to our show and delivering this wonderful lecture. And thank you, dear friends, for watching our show. Stay tuned and keep watching. Thank you.
Thank you.